Backyard Professor Chess videos. I'm Kerry Schertz, the Backyard Professor. I've got a really exciting series of videos to show you over the course of the next half a dozen videos or so. I'm going to use a common theme that I believe is very impressive in chess. I'm going to talk to you about the importance of the rooks and what to do with your rooks. It's one thing to know what you do, but it's another thing to put it into your games. I did an experiment with Jeremy Silman's materials that I am thrilled to show you about. When I first started reading about this Imbalances idea of his, I was somewhat skeptical. He would point out a position. Take this position right here. This is in his fourth edition, page 4. Superior minor piece, bishops versus knights. If you were white, would you know what to do in this position? While I'm discoursing to you for a minute, look at this position and see if you can see the imbalances. See if you can read this chessboard well enough to know what you would do as white. There's a couple of imbalances on this board, and if you use those imbalances in your favor, you can have a good game. Here is Silman's description of this. He says, compare white's bishop here. He is eyeing two really good diagonals across the board, and black's slacker knight. That knight isn't doing anything. He's back here being quiet. He's not out here in the fray. He's not centralized like the bishop and the queen. He's got good pawns here. This bishop is obviously superior to this knight. The bishop is winning this battle. When we add the other imbalances into this equation, white has an advantage in both central and queenside space. Okay? And he has a target right here on A7. Did you notice that target? I'll admit, when I first looked at this and tried to figure out the imbalances before I read his description, something he advocates you try to do, I didn't even think of this. The A7 pawn target, how do you even target it? It's obvious. You move your rook to B1, and then up here to B7, and you've got a pawn. Because your rook is supported by this powerful bishop, so that's a target. You can go get that pawn. When I first started reading Silman a while back, my first approach to this was, whoop-de-doo. I mean, so it's a pawn, you know? Big deal. I want to checkmate the king. I had the amateur's mind disease, I'm telling you. I want to find a way to get to the king. Forget the pawn over there. And then he says, not only do you have a target, not only do you have better central and queenside space, but if you were to really look at it, if you was to drop this bishop back and be able to move your queen on this diagonal, you've got a way to checkmate that king if you can get up there. Because the king is somewhat weak. He's weakened because his kingside pawns have moved. So, quite frankly, those are the imbalances in this position. And I got thinking to myself, you know, what would happen if I actually set this position up in a chess, on a chess computer? Could I really play the computer? I mean, are those small imbalances, there's a couple of things there you can do, are those enough to make a significant difference in the game? Because the way Silman describes it, he says, because of black's vulnerable king, the extra space, the potential for a checkmate, and the fact that you have a target way over here on A7, here's what Silman says about black's position. One could understand if black chose this moment to resign. And I thought, resign? Are you kidding me? For real? Black is in that bad of a situation that he ought to resign here because of a couple small imbalances like that. I was stumped. So, I set this up and I put my computer on a 2500 rating. When I set this position up, I knew, as far as testing Silman, I know my computer's not going to make any blunders. It's not going to make any bad moves. It's not going to make any weak or passive moves. So taking advantage of these imbalances, could I play a good game against the computer and see if the imbalances work? Now, I decided to try to go for the open file in with the rook. So my first move was to b1 because I'm going to target this a pawn. My opponent properly grabs the other open file. This is the correct way to use rooks. Put them on open files. I push up my rook and strike at that a7 pawn. He brings his rook up, threatening my bishop. But I know he's not going to lose the exchange, taking my bishop and losing his rook. So for all intents and purposes, that move doesn't accomplish a lot. I go ahead and take the pawn. I'm in the mood for a pawn. He, of course, takes my rook with his rook, and I exchange his rook for my rook and a pawn, so I'm up the exchange. So this is a good thing. The value of his move here now shows itself. He comes over here to a4. He's going to take my passed pawn. There's not a lot I can do about that, but with this rook, I can claim this open file again because all of my energy is on this end. I still have two pawns here that I can possibly turn into passed pawns. My effect of getting a passed pawn has been good. I've eliminated his rook and I've gained an open file. But he takes the pawn with his queen, not his rook. So now he's virtually forced me to exchange queens, which is exactly what I have to do. So he's played well. He's played very well at this point, and he takes my queen. Now at this point in the game, I'm seeing something kind of doggone cool here. My bishop is being threatened, of course. My rook has this open file. Now I can bring my rook up here and go check to the king. But the king's just going to dodge up to here to g7 and get out of check. I've got a chance to get me two really serious passed pawns, and I'm debating with myself, that would be good endgame insurance. Yeah, this way I would have the 8th rank, and I might be able to come over here and threaten the knight, and so on and so forth. But with two passed pawns, that's really good endgame insurance. I'm going to do this. I'm going to dodge down here, and I'm going to threaten the pawn. He can't come up here with the rook and protect his pawn. I'll take him. So in my opinion, that's a pretty good move. My opponent, of course, is target practicing as well. He says, oh, you're going to take a target? I'm going to take a target. You've got a pawn here I can take. We're even in material on pawns and powers at this point in the game. Both of our kings are way, way back away from the center. So it's a fairly even game. Well, I'm going to try to get endgame odds. I'm going to start taking the pawns and giving myself a passed pawn. And I'm getting pretty excited about this. And then the computer does something real interesting. The computer stops right there. He puts his rook here. And I'm thinking, well, now that's odd. But I can't just take this pawn. The knight is guarding that pawn. So I guess after all, the knight way back here doing nothing, being lazy, is actually guarding an important pawn for me. So I'm going to take that pawn, and the way I'm going to do it is I come up here and go check to the king, and sure enough, the king dodges up. And now I bring my rook over to e8. Because my intention here is I'm going to put my rook right here on e6, and then I'm going to take that pawn with my knight, with my bishop, and the knight will have to take the pawn, or take the bishop. So, I'm going to get two pawns ahead of the game here. That's going to give me two pawns insurance. Now, against my computer at 2500 rating, this is huge. And I'm kind of skeptical. I'm going, well, you know, I don't know. There's a lot of play left. And sure enough, he comes down here and checks my king. Pull my king out of check. He comes all the way over here to the end file. and I bring my rook up to here. And I'm saying, my next move, I'm going to get me a second pawn and give myself two passed pawns. I mean, this is huge. This is very, very exciting to me. And of course, my opponent comes up and goes check. I bring my king up, my opponent comes up and goes check, and I'm thinking, oh man, I don't want to have a whole bunch of just harassing checks. I'm going to put an end to this. So I start working my way toward the rook. He can't keep checking me once I get toward him. Eventually, he's going to have to move out of the way. And the other cool thing is, now my king is getting involved because of his checks, and I'm entering more into the center arena where all the play is going on, and his king's way over here out of play. So this is kind of cool, and I think the computer realized it. The computer finally dropped down to here. Now, I kind of blundered here. I got excited, and I said, yes, I've got a second pawn. You betcha, baby. So I took the pawn. He exchanged the bishop for the knight, and I was very glad to make that exchange because now material is not even, and the position is definitely in my favor. I have two wonderful passed pawns, and I have a rook and a king over here to escort them in. So I'm feeling very, very happy about this. Now, of course, my opponent is picking off my targets also. So now he's got the kingside majority of pawns, so I have to act fast to get these pawns promoted. I come up and go check to the king. The king dodges off over to here. Now he's making his way toward my pawns so he can escort his pawns in too. So now it's become a pawn race. Here I go. Here's my passed pawn. Yes siree, Bob. And look what my opponent does. I was so excited about these passed pawns, I kind of, you know, oops, I'm an amateur, what can I say? He puts me in check. Crud. And I'm thinking, you know, my advantage here, though, is when he takes this pawn, I can retake him. But he doesn't take the pawn. Instead, he moves his king up to h5. He's coming after my pawns. He realizes this pawn's going to get it. Well, I don't want to exchange. I don't want that pawn to push and then just simply be taken. I want to keep my queen. This gives him a chance to bring his king over here into the game to start taking out my pawns. I have to get my king in contact with the queening square so that when he loses his rook, I'm a rook ahead. I go ahead and promote to a queen, and of course, he instantly takes the queen. He has to take the queen, and of course, I take his rook. So I'm a rook up. I'm a rook up. The problem is, his king has devoured all of my pawns down here, and I have to promote this next pawn. I see a target. Now, he's got three pawns. For crying out loud, take the target. And I almost threw the game away doing this. I shouldn't have done this. I didn't have to do this. Well, he, of course, is going to eliminate my chance of getting another queen. He's playing dang good chess, so I have to come back over here and guard him with my rook. My king can't get to the pawn. I didn't keep my king in touch with this pawn. I kept it in touch with the last pawn. See how that works? Well, now he start running to promote. And I'm starting to think, dude, did I blow this game? Did I blow this game? So I push my pawn, and of course he pushes his pawn, and I'm going, oh my gosh, did I really do this wrong or what? I've got this far using the imbalances, and now I'm going to flub it? I have no choice. I got to go to here. And of course, my opponent, he is on his way to getting a new queen. I can still do this. I'm one away from promoting. He promotes to his queen. He's got his queen. And I'm going, ay, ay, ay. However, I have the move. Do you see what I can do? Yes, I can put him in check. Now, the cool thing about this, I'm counting my lucky stars. The cool thing about this is he's not going to move his king over here on this aisle, because I'll come straight across and take his queen. So he's virtually forced to move directly in the path of my queen. I was able to queen my pawn on my computer. Check to the king. And now he has no choice but to move to this side. And I'm not going to bore you with the details, but in 10 more moves, I checkmated him. I beat my computer, rated at 2,500, with a checkmate. Because I used the imbalances, and none of them were really huge and big and marvelous. So I did this with the second diagram. Okay, now here's the second diagram that Silman talks about in his Reassess Your Chess, Mastering the Imbalances 4th Edition. A sensational book. Everyone ought to read this and study it religiously like I'm doing. I'm working my way through it for the second time now. Here's what he says about this particular diagram. It has similarities to the other diagram. The difference now is Black's bishop is caged in and useless. And that bishop is no match for White's knight, who is the king of the universe in this magnificent outpost. He's on the 6th rank. He's penetrating the king territory powerfully so. He's holding the queen and rook at bay. That horse rules this game. That's the essential difference in the imbalances. Combined with the other favorable imbalances for White, the central, the queen side, and the king side space, this is an important imbalance. White has the ability to maneuver better because he has more space, and the fact that he's got a target on A7. You can use your rook to come to B1, come up here, and pop off that A7 pawn, and then you'll have a powerful passed pawn. That's not just any pawn. That pawn is stopping a passed pawn, as this pawn is stopping a passed pawn. When you put your rook up here, you have two targets here. So this is an important section on the pressure against the A7 and C7 pawn. And here's what Silman says. Now this is so fascinating. Because of this position, Black would be well advised to resign as quickly as possible. Isn't that fascinating? When you look at this superficially, you don't see any problem for Black. But when you notice the imbalances of the space, that magnificent knight, and the firm control of that hole in E6, and the fact that you can get an open file and you've got targets here, that's enough to make Black resign. Isn't that fascinating? So I put this in my computer, put my computer on the highest possible rating it has, 2500, Grandmaster rating, and I went to town making the imbalances that are in my favor. I wanted to see if I could play a decent game against my computer again. Okay. The first thing I decided to do was try a similar strategy with the last game because it had a similarity in it. I said, okay, I'm going to put my rook on the open file. Rooks belong on open files. When you see an open file, make use of it. That is the proper use of the rooks. This is a beautiful introduction idea to my videos on rooks that I'm going to share with you. I see the open file, I want to take the open file. Absolutely. Notice what my opponent does. He challenges me with the open file. He says, I'm not going to give you that open file for free. There's no way. Now, at this point, I have a choice. I can leave it here and move another piece, because if he comes down and takes me, I'm going to retake him, and then I'll have the open file. Or I can do a power move and come up here and take his rook and threaten his queen against his king. Now, of course, his queen will take my rook, and then I can bring my other rook over here, but then his queen can go this direction, and I can't use the 8th file. But there's another move here. Now, I've been reading Jeremy Silman, as I've said 1,000 times. He is my chess course to my master rating. Silman says in his book, there's a move here that a grandmaster will see that is so obvious, he wouldn't even hesitate to play it. And I'm really glad I read Silman before I tried this experiment, or I wouldn't have made this move, but now that I understand the logic behind it, it's the most powerful move on the chessboard right now. And I have the wonderful opportunity of making that move. Pow. Don't take the rook. Put it on the outpost. Because now he can't take that. I would have a very serious passed pawn. Either direction. And then he would be strictly on the defensive. So with that move, I'm smiling. I'm saying, hey, man, I'm starting to learn this game. I'm starting to get the hang of this. I have two targets, here or here. If I take this pawn here, my knight is backing me up because I've got that beautiful central knight on an outpost, as opposed to his measly bishop. Well, my opponent uses his measly bishop really well here. He brings the bishop up to guard that pawn. At the same time, he's opening up this rank for his rook. That's a great move. So that eliminates this pawn as my target. At this point, I want to bring the other rook and dominate that file. I want that file, period. I am announcing without hesitation or question, in this game, I own this file. This is how to use your rooks. Take a file and own that file. Absolutely. It's such a good move that my opponent concedes the file to me. He says, that's so strong, it's yours. Now, once you get the file, you have to use it. Well, I've got a target. Here. But the problem is, I can't just take it right now because I'll just simply lose my rook. So, I've got a queen here. I can pull her up one to d4 and give myself a chance to get that target. And he can't stop it. He's not going to move his queen over here to help guard that pawn, or I'm simply going to take his queen. So that pawn is now mine officially. I got the pawn. Well, he moves his rook over to here. You notice what he does. This is his open file. And he's going to use it, but I have it blocked off with the knight. But he is taking the open file. Even if it's closed off, he wants to use it. Because look at my king down here. There's nothing down here protecting my king. He's wide open. I have to keep this position closed. You see that? If I let him through, I'm in trouble here. So I don't want to let him through. I go ahead and take my pawn. Whoops. Dropped that poor pawn on its head and it said, ouch. I take the pawn and he moves his rook back out of the way. Now at this point I'm saying, you know, I don't want him to come down here. There's no way. So I move my rook back over. And of course that scares him and he moves his rook back over. But notice the difference in the position now. Now there's no black pawn here. I have a free pass pawn. And I'm gonna push it. Now I really apply some fabulous pressure against my opponent. This pawn is getting ready to promote. Now that I have this file so powerful, now I can push this rook to here. And he is in deep trouble. I'm starting to have a little bit of fun here. Because if I push my rook here, he can't take me because I've got the passed pawn and I've got it backed up. He could lose a rook and a queen. He knows that, so he does the logical move. He takes my passed pawn. That eliminates that problem. However, now I am ahead material. We were even with material. I got a pawn and a rook for a rook. I also have acquired two very good open files on the side here. I'm ahead of the game at this point. I'm winning. This strategy's paying off. He pulls his rook back to here. I do one of my favorite moves with rooks. They call two rooks on the seventh rank pigs on the seventh. These rooks are absolutely dominating the game right now, this way and on my opponent's seventh rank. I love doing this in a game. My opponent brings his bishop to here. Now, I looked at this for a while. This is a kind of a tricky move. He's offering me his bishop. Now, he's a power down already. And he is threatening my queen with it. I obviously can't take it with my queen because of the rook. I could take it with the pawn. However, here's the problem. My king is absolutely undefended. My entire army is way up here. If I take the bishop with my pawn, that opens this section up. He can start pressing pawns and opening this file for his rook and get his queen down here. I don't want him to have any counterplay. So, I don't care if he offers me my bishop. I'm not going to take that bishop. I looked at this quite a while, and I realized, Silman says this in his materials. He says, you know, when you have such a good space thrust, don't give your opponent counterplay. You don't have to. So, I let him have his bishop. I move my queen over to here to back up my rook when I put it on this file so that I can steal his queen. Now I can push my rook, and he's in double trouble. He drops his bishop down to h8, and I push this rook. Absolutely. Now I've got the queen. Now I'm really getting seriously excited. The imbalances are working. This is very exciting. I have his bishop down here in the middle of nowhere doing absolutely nothing. Way off in the dark corner of the universe, his rook has been essentially just moving around. His queen is now gone. She's lost. However, he does pull his rook back because he's going to try to make it an exchange. I'm going to get a queen and he's going to get a rook. Or is he? Why not use my wonderful knight, because he dropped his rook back, and get a free rook? He lost the exchange. I got his rook. He comes over and gets my knight. Except for one problem. I still gotta go get his queen. So he does the only thing he can. He takes my rook with my queen, with his queen, and I take his queen with my queen. In that exchange, because I have been following the imbalances that Jeremy Silman pointed out is in the position, I got a rook and a queen for a rook. And my position is absolutely a won position. If I don't blunder anything, I can win this game. Look at the discovered check I have. All I have to do is move this knight out of here somewhere. And then his king's in check. And I can bring my rook over here. I've got him. I think I'm going to beat my opponent here. This is so cool. Well, my jubilation kind of calmed down when he went like this. Check, and he skewers my rook. That's a great bishop move, man. I'm going, well, all right, I'm still going to have a queen and a knight. So I'm still going to be all right. So I got to move my king, so I move my king out of check. And then he brings his bishop back up to here. He didn't take my rook. My suspicion is, the thinking here is, I have three powers here. He has one. He has to hang on to something to help guard his king, because I'm going to be mowing him over here shortly. So he's trying his best to be as strong as he can. And it is at this point, he has no rook. He has no queen. It's at this point that I choose to destroy his pawn structure and open things up. I take his pawn with my knight and give him a discovered check with my queen. Now I've got a pawn majority and he doesn't. End game insurance. You see how that works? So he moves his king to f7. I bring my queen over to here. And, yeah, I know. There was probably a better move. I was so cockeyed excited at this time, I gave him my knight, and I shouldn't have. I admit, I gave him my knight, all right? But I took his bishop, so technically I suppose you could call that a swap, a knight for a bishop, and I'm still up, a queen and a rook. This game is over. My opponent can resign any time now. He should resign right here. Instead, he moves out of check. And I'm thinking, well, okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to head you off at the pass here. I'm going to take this rook. Whoops, I came to here. I'm going to take this rook, and I'm going to stop you from coming down over here and trying to escape. I'm going to get you. My king, his king comes to here. I bring my queen down to here, and I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to tie you up on this end, and I'm going to checkmate you. He moves his king over. And I say, holy cow, dude, you can resign any time. Check. Now I control this part of the board. He dodges back. I'm going, why are you still playing? Resign the game. It's obvious that it's over. So I go, check. And he moves back. And I'm going, you know what? I'm going to force my opponent to resign. Or I'm going to win huge. Resign already, dude. The game is over. So I bring my queen up here, and he moves his king up here. And it's dawning on me, he's not going to resign. He is not going to resign on me. So I take the pawn, and he moves his king back to here. And I'm saying, okay, fine. I'm going to go get another queen, and there's nothing you can do about it. He moves his king up. I move my pawn up. Resign, dude, resign. He moves his king down. I get a second queen. I'm going to turn that pawn upside down. That's a second queen. Resign already, man. He won't do it. He moves his king up. And I go, all right, fine. Fine. You're going to move your king back and forth stupidly. I'm going to go ahead and promote another pawn. And he will not resign. And I thought, all right, I'm going to make this super sadistic. You want to be that way? I'm going to take your pawn. He comes up to this pawn. My second queen comes down here to go check. He drops his king back down here. I take the second pawn, the next pawn, I should say. He moves his king back up here. He's really starting to make me mad. It's time to resign, dude. I've got two queens, and I've got several more pawns that can become queens. Yes, I can promote and checkmate you, but I want you to resign. Just resign the stupid game, and he won't do it. So I take his second pawn. Take his last pawn. He moves his king down, and I say, all right, fine. He moves his king back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. I push my pawn. He pushes his king up to here. He's hoping I'll push the pawn so he can take that pawn. Nothing doing. I'm going to go right to here to go check. Resign. It's over. The game is over. Resign. He will not resign. So I say, okay, fine. You're not going to say resign. You're not going to quit. I'm going to promote another queen. Now I have three queens on the board. He's still not going to resign. So I say, okay, that's cool. I'm going to push another pawn. You want to make sure that I checkmate you instead of resigning. There's a fourth queen on the board. He moves his king back and forth. I move my queen over to here. He moves his king back down. He's absolutely being obstinate. He should resign any time. Computers resign games. They truly do. And I decide, you know what? I might make YouTube history here. Because insanely enough, I have five queens on the board, man. And he will not resign. So, I finally promote the sixth queen, and with six queens, I finally checkmate his king. Six queens! You saw it here on YouTube. Against a computer rated at 2,500. Because I used the imbalances. Look, it's exciting for an amateur to find such a fabulous system of chess that really does work. As objectively and as scientifically and as accurately as I know how, I tested Mr. Silman's imbalances ideas with as strong an opponent as I could find. And it worked. That's fabulous. Silman's correct. This is as powerful a proof as I can show you that it's possible. It really is possible. So, thank you for watching my chess videos. I enjoy them. I enjoy making them for you. It helps reinforce it in my mind on how to look for imbalances and what to look for. Like I love to say, man, happy checkmating. And I will see you in the next videos.